My due is to talk on astigmatism, and we all need to understand that the way we stand today, patient wants an ultimate vision restoration, and correcting astigmatism is actually gives great visual impact to the patient without the trade-offs which come with a multifocal IO. So I'm going to run you through the different pearls. The first important thing which we need to look at is that when we counsel our patients, we first need to do a biometry to know whether the patient has any amount of astigmatism, rather than launching off into seeing the cataract and talking about all the premium IOLs which you have. Because if there is a toricity there, then it makes sense to decide whether you're going to place an eye multifocal or the patient can afford a multifocal and a toric. So biometry before a counseling is absolutely mandated. Why is it not moving? So sorry. Going further, we need to also know whether it's a regular corneal astigmatism and whether the patient has a healthy corneal surface, ocular surface. That's important. The second thing which we need to do is to verify the raw data. Now here, if you look carefully, the patient has 2 diopter plus astigmatism in the left eye, whereas 0.5 in the right eye. Assuming that it is asymmetric, we should first look whether your biometry is right, whether the dry eye status is right. And believe me, this patient had severe dry eyes, and after lubricating and after taking care, when we repeated the biometry, what we learned was that the astigmatism was same in the both eyes. So that's one more message for you. The choice of the formulae, we have done a study, and many of you would have known that the third generation formulas work fine in normal eyes to an extent. But if you have access to the best of the formulae, you get more than 90% of your patients within plus minus 0.5, and you want to be premium for all your patients. So there are n number of data which have to be incorporated for the Barrett variables, which have to be incorporated, which makes your results so much better. You need to know your toric calculator. Like whether it has the Barrett algorithm incorporated in it, whether this particular toric IOL calculator has a mathematical way of calculating the posterior corneal astigmatism. If you have a Barrett algorithm incorporated as in the Alcon, then it takes care of your toricity ratio, the keratometric index, the centroid values. So different IOL toric calculators today are most promising. And if you do not have access to it, you have your immersion biometry, you could still feed in the data in the Barrett toric calculation online. You need to just feed in the IOL constant data because of the acoustic constant, which would be different, but still you would be able to get the best of the details. As I was going to show you, that the keratometry in this particular case has been done on the immersion, and you feed in all these data. Remember to add that toric IOL constant in it, and it will give you all the data, how to position a lens and what is the least residual astigmatism. Now looking at the next step. Now, if it is a with the rule astigmatism, you could probably go beyond 1.5 and then plant the toric IOL. But if it is an against the rule, we need to know that the posterior cornea is going to add more to it. So you would actually become sensitive to start using correcting with toric IOL even from 0.8 or less. So if the toric calculator would tell you whether you would implant an IOL in this particular astigmatism or would you not go ahead with it. Then this was a particular case of a trifocal which was promised to the patient. The patient did have some amount of astigmatism, and the end result was that the patient had a small amount of residual refractive error. This was an education that no, I could have done better for this patient. The patient was also cognizant. He was told about the astigmatism earlier, but he wanted even greater accuracy, and thus a panoptic toric was planned in the left eye with a LLVC in the right eye. And finally, the patient did optimally well. So what we understand from this is that a multifocal IOL, it is very sensitive to even small amount of toricity. And if that is addressed, the patients are most optimally happy. So you need to lower your threshold for using toric IOLs with a multifocal. Now, this is another case wherein, again, a trifocal was planned, but the amount of astigmatism, as you can see, is plus 0.67 and plus 0.55. So you need to think of another angle of approach. So what do? If you have access to a femtocataract platform, you could place arcuate incisions as what was planned here. And that took care of the correction of the astigmatism. And lo and behold, the patient was doing well. So we need to be, when you talk of toric IOLs, you need to try your best to ensure that you look into all of these pearls, which are so critical. Now, supposing you have a high amount of astigmatism, a keratoconus eye, which underwent a DALC surgery, you need to wait till all the sutures are removed and look at the amount of astigmatism. About 6 diopter of astigmatism is there. Of course, the patient deserves some amount of quality of vision to be brought in. So you would go ahead and plan placing a toric IOL. Of course, you would have to do a customized IOL. You need to look into all the data, whether all of it are right. Then look into the Barrett TK toric, and then it would tell you what should be done. And then you have a patient with just minus one cylinder, which is fine because the patient has been struggling throughout his life. You would really optimize this quality of vision. Then comes Pearl 8, nailing the target axis. See now how you could do it. You could do it on a slit lamp, marking the 3 o'clock, 9 o'clock, and then the slit beam goes right to the center of the pupil, or you could use the Asiko bubble marker. But when you use the Asiko bubble marker, even if you position it, you could be a little 5-10 degrees off or low. So you need to optimize on that. You need to ensure that it's just a dot mark with a needle. It is, the marking area is dry. You don't use too much of ink. I'm not showing all that. And when it comes to the doing the surgery, you would do the all the steps of the surgery optimally. But before you position it in the final locking position, you remove the viscoelastic in front and behind the IOL, push the IOL against the posterior capsule, and then you would go ahead and lock it into final position and then get out of the case. Pearl 9 is the last one. Is if it is off axis on the slit lamp itself, you know that how much it is misaligned from where it should be. You could feed it into the astigmaticsfix.com, and then it would tell you how off you are. Like here, the patient was at 170, whereas it should have been at 85. So then what now you need to know is the spherical equivalent has to be zero. If the spherical equivalent is zero, you could rotate the lens. And if it is not zero, that means there's an IOL issue there. Either you place a piggyback lens or you remove the IOL or you do a bioptics for the residual refractive error. But if it is a spherical equivalent is zero, then you could go ahead and rotate these lenses and they do well. So how long would you wait before you go to realign? You could wait for at least a week or two, no harm in that. The capsule contracts a little, it would stay or be more stable for the IOL placement. Then you could go ahead and rotate. So we need to look at all these parameters, patient selection, IOL selection, IOL power calculator, axis aligning post-operatively. And believe me, if you follow all these pearls, you would be on dot in every single case of your toric IOL implant or your astigmatism management. Thank you.